Hello everybody, and welcome to another Anime Thoughts and Opinions video. The disclaimers that used to be listed at the beginning of these videos are now listed at the top of the description down below. Those disclaimers are important to help you in understanding the style of this discussion video. You know, I remember back in the day when we first started using those disclaimers, and I had to write them down on a small sheet of paper and read them off from that. Yeah. How far we've come. That's called technology, also known as the brain. But anyways, today we're going to be talking about our next anime listing after finishing Evangelion last time, and its film, and that was Kaguya-Sama, Love is War, which is, well, this is going to be a bit of an interesting video, I'm sure, though don't expect an Evangelion-length video. I've got some stuff to say, but I don't think we're going to be romping around for 2 hours here, but we'll see. So, this anime was a television show that ran for 12 episodes at the average 24 minutes per episode and released in 2019, so it's relatively recent, but also 2019 is getting further behind us the more time passes, obviously. So, 2019 to me feels recent, but it was actually a couple years ago. What the hell? The studio behind it was A1 Pictures, and it is listed as a comedy, psychological, romance, slice-of-life show. Alright, so my nose is itching now. Okay, this was very, very risky for me. Now, just to remind you, or I say remind as if, you know, that implies that you already knew ahead of time and then I came back to let you know again. But how I had set this up was a long time ago, not going to go through the whole story, but I had watch lists set up. That I was watching about 30 anime per watch list, and I was going to try to get through them. Unfortunately, that didn't work out. Funnily enough, it was created back in 2019. And so, I've been slowly trying to catch up on that over the past couple years, and we're getting to it now, finally. And I'm cutting through a lot of the anime. That's what I've mostly been watching recently. But to do that, I would go to my watch list, and I would pick a handful of anime off of it. For really, really old school viewers might remember that back in the day, I used to put all of the anime suggestions I got from a certain list on my paste bin, which can be found in the description as well, on little slips of paper, and I'd put them in this bowl, which I still have sitting here. And you know it's old because there are shows in here like Shinsekai Yori in here, and that's a show I've already watched and covered back in 2019, so you know that I have not used this method in a while. But what I would used to do, I would pick two anime from my list that I wanted to watch, just that I thought were interesting looking, and then I would draw two anime at random. Well, Kaguya-sama was one that I chose by random. I did the same system. I had chosen Evangelion and its movie myself, and then I had also chosen another show, which we're going to be covering after this one. And then this and another one I don't want to reveal just yet were chosen by random. And I was somewhat excited but also a little bit apprehensive to watch this, because the only reason I was excited was just because I've heard good things. But I've heard good things about a lot of shows that I cannot stand. So that doesn't mean too much to me anymore. Now, originally, the reason why I had added this show to my list, you know, it wasn't like an, ooh, it's a romance, I want to add that to my list, or it wasn't necessarily... I had seen the Chica dance on the internet, and that's the reason why I added the show. The entire reason I had the show was for that stupid dance. And it only plays in one episode at the very end, and that's it. So yeah, that's how this thing got to my list. I'm sure it would have found its way. I'm sure somebody had suggested it somewhere at some point. What are the reasons why I was afraid to watch this? Well, for those of you that have been around for at least a little while, you probably already know how I am with these shows. I have a rocky relationship with rom-coms, for starters. And I knew that this was a romance comedy going in, or a comedy romance, but what had happened when I sat down to watch this with my co-op partner, I realized there was actually more scary shit about this show before I had started it that I had found out. For example, that it runs a very high parody match, and I despise parody. There's been even less success rate with parody than anything else on my analyst. And I also found that it ran a very high tsundere match. Again, another one of my least favorite things in anything ever is at least in terms of dairy types, is the tsundere. And I was not looking forward to that. And then I had also been told ahead of time that that people did not think I was going to like this show very much. I had a friend tell me that as well. And that makes sense because it's not my thing. This type of show really isn't my style. It's just not what I really enjoy from time, you know, from when I'm watching shows from time to time. So that makes sense that people would believe that. And I believed that, and I was scared. But, well, not to mention, I also just got done watching Evangelion, which was such a specific type of experience, and especially the end of Evangelion movie, that sometimes when you watch something that's that impactful to you, and then you go to watch something else, it just doesn't add up to what you had just watched, and that kind of destroys your feelings of the show even more. But over the years of watching anime, I have learned to give everything at least one chance. That's why I add anything and everything to my list, no matter how fucking terrifying it looks, because it's a rom-com, because I've watched shows that I thought I was not going to like in the past and liked them, and I've watched shows I thought I was going to like and didn't like them. The only way to know is to watch. Yeah, I can judge it by its genre or its looks, all week long if I wanted to, but that's not actually going to give me an idea of what the show is until I watch it, or at least start watching it. So we gave it a chance, or I gave it a chance, that is, and... Well, now we're going to talk about it. That's the whole point for this. Now, I'd love to take you through my whole fucking spiel with why all of those things are issues for me usually, and why I just don't like rom-coms and all that kind of stuff. I can enjoy comedy. The problem why I don't really enjoy it, without going into too much complicated detail, is I just think that anime comedy is awful most of the time. I think that it's really flat comedy. It's obnoxious comedy. You basically need to I don't want to say that because that might be too rude for people that do enjoy it. I don't mean to come off that way. To me, it's just very flat, obnoxious comedy. That's why I tend to not enjoy comedy shows in the anime field. And romance is one of my highest rated genres. It's the genre. It's one of the genres that I go for in anything. So when you take something I think is obnoxious and put it with something that I think is great, well, you can see why that would have disastrous results. I like to watch the romance. I don't like the comedy getting in the way. which is why you'll find that I tend to lean more towards dark shows or mature shows, or shows that have, they don't necessarily have to have violence or anything of the sort. When I say mature, I'm talking, adult shows. Shows that, they take the shit a little bit more seriously when it comes to romance or whatever. And no, just because it's a drama romance does not mean characters have a nasty breakup, or does not mean that somebody dies or there's some tragedy in it. Drama romance just fits the bill for being more adult. Instead of having all these giggly googly laughs and comedic relief characters, it's more of a serious relationship type of a deal. And that's more my style when it comes to this kind of show. So with that in mind, it should give you some idea as to why I was not looking forward to actually sitting down and watching this. And to boot, parody is basically comedy, but it is the worst kind of comedy if not done right. To this day, I have only ever watched, not counting this show, I've only ever watched one parody that I actually thought was pretty clever, and that was One Punch Man. Because I think in my Kaguya notes, I wrote down that a really good example of what I consider to be a bad parody, which this is one of those controversial topic or opinions that I have, it's like a hot take, is Konosuba. I think that it is a very, very bland parody comedy. It's a one-dimensional comedy. And that's the type of parody that I despise. It is not funny at all to me. So I'm always, always raising red flags when someone brings up, or I notice that this is a parody, or what I'm about to watch is a parody. With all that being said, this show managed to wiggle its way around a lot of the issues I have with that type of comedy or with parody. It even went overboard on some spots to make it very enjoyable of an experience by the end. Because within the first two episodes, because we had watched two episodes on the first day, and then we had gone for like, I don't know, two or three days maybe without watching anything. So all I had to go off of was those two episodes. And I honestly was not very, very, very excited, because those two episodes, it's not that I didn't like them, because there were still some funny moments in them. It was just that those two episodes were not, I didn't like them, because it wasn't that I didn't like them. I just didn't think that they were good, if that makes sense. I don't know, whatever. I didn't like the frantic scene pacing. In fact, that's probably overall the thing I didn't like most about this show, was the pacing of each individual scene. The scenes shoot by fast. There is constantly things shooting around the screen. The dialogue is zipping by super quick, and this show loves to put dialogue all over the fucking screen. And if you're shooting your eyes around at the top of the screen, the bottom of the screen, the sides of the screen, and these lines only remain there for a second or two apiece, it's very hard to keep up with what everybody is saying, and thus you might miss out on some of the details. Now, you might just say, well, why don't you watch the dub? Well, because I don't want to scoop my eyeballs out with a spoon, though I don't actually know what the dub quality is like in this show. I've heard some people watch it because it's actually funnier. Maybe I'll check it out someday just for that case. We'll see. that's the only thing overall that I actually had issues with this show, was just the pacing of the scenes. But mostly, everything else was pretty good. You know, it kind of took me by surprise that I wasn't disappointed with my experience of the show itself, of the core episodes. The only thing that I would say that was a disappointment for me was the last episode. And we'll get to that, obviously, but that was the only thing that, with the show's story itself, that was probably the only thing that I wasn't too big a fan of. But otherwise, there wasn't a character that I didn't like. You know, because another thing that's really common about comedies is that there's constantly at least a character that is so annoying, that is so fucking annoying, that it makes me hate the show because they exist. I don't really have any of that in this show. There is no character that I don't like, and there's only a few core characters. And the room that they live in, yes, they live in this room. The student council office that they basically have every single episode in becomes its own character throughout the show too, because it is the room you see in practically every episode for basically the entire episode. You'll see some scenes outside this room, but overall, you're going to spend 95% of your time in here, so you're going to have to make the room memorable. And I remember this room. I remember it now. It reminds me kind of like the room from K-On!, the club room, because it's a room that you just remember for years after you had watched the show, because it's always there. And it fits, because this is a slice of life show, so you would imagine that you're going to see them just doing their thing, and these characters operate within this office, so you're going to see them in the office all the time. The story itself of exactly what these characters do is not important. That's not at all the focus of the show. It's more for the comedic romance portion. But as far as the show goes, essentially the idea is love is war, obviously. So you have two characters. You have Kaguya, and then you have Miyuki, who are the two main characters, our two romantic lovebirds in the show. And the thing is I've never seen a show do this before, so this was new to me, which may have added to my interest rate level with it. You know, because I can watch a type of show, like a genre of show or a style of show that I've already seen 100 times, but if I already like that type of thing, then it's not going to get old for me. Then you have comedy romance. I don't like it to begin with, so if I keep watching comedy romance, it's not like it's just going to suddenly get better. It's just going to stay that I don't like it. But this show doesn't give me a standard comedy romance to go with. It gives me this unique idea that I've not seen before, so that might have actually contributed to my overall interest and enjoyment as the show went on. Anyways, basically the whole show is these two characters attempting to get the other one to confess their love for them. And it's a fun concept, but the catch, which makes it interesting, and my throat is dying. I couldn't tell, you know, if you couldn't tell already. The catch is that they actually both already have feelings for one another. And it's assumed that they already had feelings prior to when the show started. But the thing is you actually see these feelings get stronger and stronger and stronger as these 12 episodes go by. You know, it's not like right at the start they're already in love, at least deeply. They have feelings. And then halfway through the show, you notice, oh shit, those feelings are getting really strong. And then by the end of the show, they're ready to fuck. It really does progress as the show goes on. But you kind of have to watch for that. So most of the episodes are basically just a collection of almost like mini games or challenges where these characters are outwitting each other with dialogue, as that's what most of this show is just scenes of them sitting around in the office fucking each other with dialogue until one of them wins or one of them loses. Though throughout this show, nobody actually confesses, so the war is not over, so to speak. Though they practically outright give you that by the end of the show anyways, and I said outright again, that's something I've said quite a bit recently, I need to stop doing that. They essentially just, I don't know, that's what was, whatever, fuck it. I don't want to get too far ahead of myself about the ending. I keep wanting to talk about the ending because that's the thing I keep wanting to talk about. That's the thing that's going to be the more complicated part of this video. But yeah, that's the show. And then you also have some additional characters that are kind of like either support or comedic characters. See, the thing is I can't necessarily call a character like Chica comedic relief, because the idea of comedic relief is that they are a comedic character that is meant to relieve the stress from anything else in the show. That's what a comedic relief character is. That's why they're called relief. But this is already a comedy to begin with, and both our two main characters, everything they do is for the sake of comedy anyways for us as the viewer, with the exception of like the final episode, which turns into comedy anyways. So Chica being there is just an additional comedic character rather than being the comedic relief. But what makes, here's the thing about Chica, right? Because she's kind of like, I'd call her the third character, the third main character. She's, as my co-op partner referred to her as, ditzy. And she's the exception to the rule that I'm about to talk about. See, the thing that I also really liked about this show was the fact that the characters are not dumb as fuck. Again, the idea behind a comedy show, especially comedy romance, is I guess it's funny because they write the characters to be fucking idiots. You know, and I know it's a comedy. It doesn't have to be realistic. It doesn't have to be real life. But people, it's so annoying to see that everybody has to be a fucking dumbass in these shows. You know, they're inept to everything around them because that's funny. Lol, we can get a whole bunch of jokes out of that. This show doesn't do that. For example, there's a scene later where Kaguya gets sick because she had water splashed on her. Okay, it's ridiculous. That's ridiculous, but we'll get to it, right? She gets sick, right? And the person who ended up causing that to happen was Miyuki himself, but he didn't realize it when it had happened. However, afterwards, after she had gotten sick and whatever, and they're talking about it, he realizes on his own, without too much implication at all, almost immediately, that, oh shit, I was probably the one. She was waiting for someone at the gate, and I was the one that most likely had caused it. Right away, he had realized he was the problem there, and he went to try to fix the issue himself. You know how that might sound super normal to you? That might sound like, oh yeah, well duh, that's common sense, right? Exactly, that's common sense. That's a person who is not written to be a dumbass in a show just because it's a comedy romance. You would be surprised how inept they write these characters. You know, Chica? That's basically how they write every character in every fucking comedy I've ever watched, because that's apparently funny. Chica here, however, as I said, aside from the exception, is that she is not annoying to me. She's actually really cute. She's very funny. And most of her scenes she's in, most of the scenes that made me laugh harder were because Chica was there. She's definitely the ditzy character. She's definitely the, hey, this is what usually you see in a comedy show. But for some reason, she was a lot more charming to watch. I don't know exactly if I could give, you know, a one-to-one reason as to why that is. But she was. She was fun. There's some really humorous scenes where there's the wiener scene, you know, grade school. They even say in the show that, you know, only grade schoolers would laugh at something like that. And yet, both myself and my co-op partner are busting out because of this stupid wiener joke that she keeps saying wiener. And I don't know why she started talking about her dog and how its wiener is, like, bent to the left and it's a really weird wiener. It's like, stop saying it. Oh, my God. It was hilarious, though. Also, one of the things that was really funny, and I even used it as my teaser for this anime on my Twitter, was right at the start, they sit down to eat lunch, and they've got their little bento boxes, right? And I just said, as a joke, I was like, oh, are they going to have those little hot dogs that are, like, cut into octopi shapes, you know? Because that's what you always do in anime, right? And, of course, they open the lid, and there they are. There's the little wieners cut into octopi shapes. And I was like, see? I told you. But what made it funny to me was they actually made that part of the episode out for the octopus hot dogs. They made it a whole part of the show, and were, you know, and I just did not expect that at all. I've never seen them specifically focus on those freaking hot dog wieners. And you see them in every show that's ever existed ever. I've never had one. I've never had a little wiener cut into an octopi shape. I should do that sometime just to see. I don't know how you get the black dots for the eyeballs, though. So yeah, overall, most of these scenes were entertaining, and the scenes that were not entertaining were just that. They just weren't entertaining. But nothing was annoying. Nothing, you know, ground on my brain, so to speak. Everything was just either okay and straightforward, or yeah, this is pretty funny. With the exception of the last episode, of course, like I had said before. So that was surprising to me. That was the first major turnaround that I had for this show. That I wasn't expecting. Now, as far as, like, other comedic stuff goes, well, we can talk a little bit about some of the basic things in the show, since, you know, like I said, the story's not too important. You know, it's not important that they're all at a school that's for basically rich people. That doesn't matter to me, because that's not important at all. I guess you can argue it is important for specifically Kaguya, but I'm not going to argue that. You've got the visuals. Okay, so I did not mind the visuals at all. I quite like the art style. Kaguya's art style, drawing, whatever, is really good. I do not like the men. That's usually how it goes. I never like how they draw men in these shows. I don't like the style of them at all. But all of the female characters, for the most part, I really enjoyed. And of course, Kaguya is the most overused color palette on the planet, red and black, but the reason it's so overused is because it is so fucking hot. And I don't mean hot as in sexy, it is just a really hot color palette. Red's a very hot color. And you'll notice that red and black work great as evil colors. Now, she's not an evil character, and I'll get to her whole tsundere trope here in a minute. But they portray her in all these different ways in the show. She's kind of comes off as a bit of a yandere at times, and it's awesome when they do that. The visual effects they use for that is just awesome to watch. And she's very funny when she starts getting all, you know, like she's gonna murder you. I enjoyed watching those scenes, because there's a fourth member of the council office as well. That's Ishigami, I believe. He shows up out of nowhere. I don't know what the fuck his deal is, but they just suddenly introduce him into the show. And he's kind of like, you know, and I actually, because, of course, we're talking about a rom-com, and I want to get serious here, and I want to talk about some serious stuff. There is a couple things I do want to talk about Ishigami, because he's not the character I necessarily relate to one-to-one, but he is a character that does some relatable things, or says some relatable things, that are reasons why I have social anxieties. And thus, he was a character I found actually to be quite entertaining because of that. And then additionally, there's Kaguya's, like, maid servant, practically, because she's from a very rich family, and she's basically been served everything her whole life. And I think her name was... I wrote it down, fuck it. Obviously, she wasn't important enough for me to remember. Sorry to anyone that considers her your waifu, but... her name was Hayasaka. So she's there in some scenes. In fact, she's actually very helpful in the final episode. Anyhow, visual-wise, yes. Enjoyed that stuff. I forgot where I was going with the whole serious stuff. I think I'll cover that afterwards. Soundtrack-wise, I don't know. It's okay. I mean, like, the bass soundtrack that plays just in the show, in the regular scenes, it's kind of what I would expect from a slice of life. It's almost very Victorian sounding, probably because the school that they are in is very S tier. It gets the job done, we'll put it that way then. The opening itself is not too bad. I didn't like it at first because, yes, I'm sexist, it had a guy singing. I wasn't too big on it at first, but it kind of grew on me as the show went on. Definitely better than some of the recent openings I said have grown on me as the show went on. In fact, I'd go as far to say that I like it better than Cruel Angel Thesis, because I really do not like the techno jazz in that song. Meanwhile, this one was very kind of almost similar in genre, but I don't know, it wasn't techno-y, so I guess that was the part that made me like it a little bit more. But of course, the best thing was that one scene you get to see the Chica dance. I don't know what the song is, I don't know if it's got a specific name to it, but I just call it the Chica dance because she dances. It was memed to fuck, and it's the thing that got me to want to watch the show, or at least it got me to add the show originally. You get to see it once. It's very nice. I wish the chorus was longer, but of course you're going to want anything good to be longer. This scene is also rotoscoped, which means that it's essentially, I don't really know how to explain rotoscope animation. It's basically where they animate over top of a real actor, essentially, and it gets this really smooth animation to it that looks very fluid, very realistic. So when you watch Chica dancing, which she does throughout like the whole show, she's always doing something stupid, which is funny. This is the funny stupid, right? She's always bouncing around or dancing, or she fucking raps at one point, which is hilarious when she does that. Anyways, her whole dance is very, very fluid, very, 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 I almost said the word suspenseful, that's not the right word. What's the word I'm looking for? The word that you use went satisfying. There you go. It was very, unlike the ending of this show, her dance was very satisfying. Likewise, visually for the show, they use a lot of really nice facial expressions across all of the characters. Sometimes they use these really weird, like they'll use a fisheye lens type of effect on a character, or there are scenes where the characters do, like they animate the characters really weirdly. Like I think there's a scene where Miyuki's head just gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and then the scene cuts away. I don't know. They do stuff like that, and it's so bizarre when it happens that it's funny. It's a funny type of bizarre, and it fits the scene. It fits the dialogue that they're having. You know, it's not just random for being random. It kind of goes along with what you're watching, which again adds this consistency to the comedy that is usually something I find hit or miss, and so that's going to help me actually enjoy the comedy more. As for some of the more basic things that I wasn't too big on, or at least not necessarily disliked, but just things that I was kind of neutral on or just wasn't so sure about. First one, which is pretty big, is actually Kaguya's voice actress. I didn't think her voice fit the character at all, especially just her standard voice, like her normal self that's, not acting cutesy or whatever. I think that sounds fine, but her normal voice, she sounds like it's a 40-year-old woman voicing this young girl, and it sounds like a 40-year-old woman voicing the girl. That's the only reason why I felt that way. Maybe it doesn't sound like that to other people, it just sounded like that to me, but then again, I've just watched a few older anime, so maybe I'm just sensitive to picking up on older voice actresses. I don't know. Maybe it's a young voice actress that sounds old. I don't really know. I never looked into it. But, I don't know, that's just something that I felt when watching the show. Now, as for, on the topic of Kaguya, I want to talk a little bit about her tsundere trope. So the thing with her whole dere stuff is that she's actually not stereotypical. See, usually, because romance comedies can't do anything to be at least somewhat clever, it's, oh, you're a tsundere, haha, I don't like you, I would never like you, and then, they'd blush. Wow, very nice. Very, very, very original. Also very fucking annoying, because I cannot stand girl characters that are basically bitches or dicks for the sake of hiding their feelings. I'm not into that. Yet, for some reason, it is everyone's favorite fucking thing under the sun. So, you can understand, with how I feel about it, why I would be terrified to know that this show, on top of everything else, was running a tsundere character alongside it. She doesn't do that. Yeah, she acts like that sometimes, but there's always something that keeps it from being terrible. You know, like, when she is acting all, flustered and stuff, she's visually acting flustered, very obviously having, and it's not just that she's hiding her effects, or her feelings. She is literally terrible at hiding her feelings. So much so that, again, because these characters are not inept, both her and Miyuki pick up on each other's feelings when they see each other, and sometimes Miyuki, for example, overthinks things, which is so realistic. You have no idea how realistic that is to overthink anything that's even simple about another character. And you know that it's obvious that she's acting that way when Chika can pick up on it. If Chika can pick up on it, then it's obvious she's flustered and trying to hide something, right? So I really enjoyed that aspect. And the fact that they mix her comedy with other types of dairy, like I said, sort of like a Yandere effect at times, and they do a really good job with that too, it makes her enjoyable to watch and fun to watch rather than being, well, a bitch, an annoying bitch. That being said, you do get some semi-flashback scenes where you see them before this show had started, and she had her hair down. It wasn't up in, like, that tie with her, the back of her hair or whatever. That would have been a terrible version of her to watch. She was not enjoyable in those scenes at all. So if they went with that route, then holy fuck, I would not have liked her as a character at all throughout this show. That's the type of dairy stereotype that I cannot stand. But thankfully, we didn't get that with the final product, and thankfully it allowed me to enjoy the experience, again, a lot more than I had expected originally. So overall, there was quite a few enjoyable scenes throughout the show. There's, I think, in episode 3, they do this whole skit thing about virgins, and I don't know, I thought the way that they handled virgins was kind of funny, and how, with the way Kaguya was raised, she didn't know what sex was. You know, she didn't know what intercourse or anything was. It does not exist in her brain, basically. She thought that sex was basically kissing, and that was how far you could go. You couldn't go beyond kissing. So when she was talking about how she had done it with her nephew, you know, and how Chica's probably done it with her dog, it was kind of like the wiener scene. They keep dragging it out, but they drag it out just enough to be funny as opposed to getting old, and that was an enjoyable scene because of it. We also get to see some funny scenes with I wouldn't necessarily say it's a funny scene per se, but the way that they kind of handle the earlier episodes with the later episodes, they're kind of parallel to each other, right? Or they come back around, they come full circle. It's like, for example, there's this background character, this guy, that has these feelings for this girl, and he comes to Miyuki, who has no experience himself, asking for advice. And Miyuki basically helps him get the girl. And it works. He gives advice, and usually a comedy romance would make this big funny scene because, haha, boy is being rejected, how funny, because, you know, that's what people like to laugh at these days. And that's not what happened. Instead, the guy actually got with the girl. But you'll find in a later episode, that girl comes to Kaguya for advice because she feels like maybe, you know, she has these feelings, but she doesn't know what these feelings are yet. And she was kind of felt pressured into saying yes to the guy that was asking her out. And so now we've got Kaguya giving advice, and the advice that's given, which is taken kind of the wrong way, ends up getting those background characters to stick together in the end anyways, you know, and find something to like about each other. And that's, you know, where you really dig underneath that hard, scabby outside layer of, that's disgusting, when you dig underneath that thick skin that Kaguya has on the exterior, and you see exactly what she's like underneath. That's the best part about her character. Now, I know Tsundere fans are going to say,
that's exactly what Tsunderes are like. They're always really hot and sweet underneath their thick skin.
Yeah, but they act like bitches. That's what I don't like. I don't care that they're sweet underneath. If they act like a dick, they're a dick, period. So you get to see, like, for example, when she talks about how what's important is finding the little things you like about a guy, and then that will form into new things and more things and more things. And as time goes on, you'll feel those feelings grow stronger and stronger. And you know she's talking about Miyuki as she discusses this with this girl. So that's what makes her enjoyable as a romantic interest. And you'll see scenes all like that throughout the show too with her. There's a pretty enjoyable scene as well where they're speaking French. And I tried looking it up because supposedly Miyuki gets insulted greatly by this French woman, right? Or this woman that speaks French. And then Kaguya comes up and just starts ripping into her in French, but they don't show you what they're saying. Well, I looked it up because I wanted to know exactly what they were saying. Apparently, it's actually gibberish. It's not actually French that they're speaking. I could be wrong on that. That's just what I found, the information I found. Because they wanted the viewer themselves to feel like Miyuki, in that you just don't know what they're saying. You have to interpret what they were saying. And again, this is another great example of Miyuki not being an inept character. Hell, I would probably be this inept in real life, but he realizes that Kaguya got involved, not randomly, but because that woman had to have been insulting him. Even though he didn't understand what she was saying, Kaguya came to help. And he picked up on that and realized that. And again, that's part of the thing that I loved about how they wrote these characters. They are not fucking stupid, which is so refreshing to see that specifically in a comance, that's a comedy romance, in a romance, for fuck's sake, in a rom-com. There we go. I'll just say rom-com since that's what my brain seems to be on. Comance, romance, Jesus Christ. There's the whole umbrella scene. There's all, like I said, with the Yandere stuff, which was really cute. There's the whole wiener scene, which is in episode 7, which was really fucking hilarious. Let's see. I'm looking through my notes just to see if I can find anything. There's some other weird scenes that, like, they don't go into detail. Like, for example, there's a thunderstorm at one point and Chica is terrified about her belly button. I don't understand that. That's humor for this generation because it makes no sense, and that's what makes it funny, I guess. I don't know. It was funny because I didn't understand it, and they don't explain it. I don't think they explained it. Anyways, it was cute too because she's afraid of thunder, and I don't like thunder either. Except I'm not worried about my belly button. I don't know where that belly button thing comes from. Maybe it's because the thunder rumbles your abdomen area, so it feels like your belly button's gonna pop up. Maybe she has an outie. I don't know. Maybe the outie feels like it's gonna pop out. Whatever. I'm not around to ask her, I guess. let's see. Okay, so at this point in the show, this is where things start to kind of roll into the final episode. So I'll get to that, because when Kaguya gets sick, that's kind of what leads into the final bits. So everything beforehand, the only other stuff I kind of wanted to talk about was Ishigami. So he was a relatable character. Like, for example, at one point he says he's going to study, right? And then the narrator, who I didn't even mention the narrator, there's a narrator for this show, and he talks basically from the beginning of the show all the way to the end too, right? And he's pretty entertaining. You know, as far as narrators go, he doesn't get in the way of any of the scenes. When the characters are doing their thing, the characters are doing that thing. When the narrator needs to pop in, he pops in. But I thought it was funny when Ishigami was like, oh, yep, gonna study really hard, and he walks out the door and the narrator pops in and says, he's lying. He's going home to play that game he picked up earlier, which was so relatable, it's not even funny. But to get onto a more serious topic, and I don't mean to turn this into, you know, hey, Tigerfrost is depressed, so how about we talk about his feelings? But it was something that picked up for me. So Ishigami has a specific view on girlfriends, for example, which I thought was relatable. Because as someone who does not have a partner or hasn't had a partner, when you see people with their partners or you see people who have partners yet they don't spend time together, it's one of those frustrating things, because you're like, you've got one. You know, get in that. And no, I don't mean sex. Go out, do things, have fun, because you have that, as people like myself do not have that, don't have that luxury. And I felt that frustration when he was going through that scene. It was, again, and that's the thing, because when they do these somewhat serious scenes, they don't ruin it with a stupid punchline. Now, this was kind of more comedic, but more specifically at the end, when characters get emotional, they don't jump in and say, haha, joke time, like a normal rom-com would. So thankfully, these scenes, which I would have preferred if there wasn't any serious stuff in the show at all, because it doesn't fit, in my opinion. Maybe season 2 would handle it a lot better, I don't know. I haven't seen season 2. But as far as the serious stuff goes, it just didn't fit with the rest of the show for me. And that's to be expected for a rom-com. I do not think those two things go together. You cannot put comedy with something that's supposed to be serious. And, you know, that's where people might argue, well, that's the point of comedy. It's to take the tension out of the serious scenes. You may be right sometimes, but the reason I can't agree is because the comedy ruins the tension. That tension is what makes the serious stuff enjoyable. That's what makes it entertaining. That's what makes you feel for these characters. And then when you ruin it with the comedy, you know, it takes away from that tension. It breaks any kind of immersion you might have had. And I'm not saying that that's what this show does. I'm just saying in general, that's the reason why I don't like serious stuff being ruined with comedy. And while it was not directly ruined in this show, you still have the serious scenes backed by comedy scenes, and it just feels out of place for me. I would have preferred that they didn't either did more of the serious stuff or didn't do it at all in this show. I would have been better off that way. Anyhow, another thing with Ishigami was that he talks. At one point, Chika walks into the room and she used a different type of conditioner on her hair. Okay. Now here's the thing. They played this up to be a joke, but the way that Ishigami reacts to it is the same way that I react to it as well, not just real life wise, but in shows like this when I watch them, because usually it's he would make this compliment that he's going to make, and then all the characters say, wow, you're a creep, and then that's it, funny, everyone laughs and then everyone moves on. But the way that Ishigami actually specifically responds to it is exactly how I feel in regards to this kind of thing. So he compliments her hair because he can smell it. He can smell that she's wearing a different type of conditioner. Now, I just want to let everyone know, I don't know about you, but you don't have to sniff a girl's ass to know if she had put something else in her hair. If you walk within, you know, a mile of a woman that has put something in their hair, a dude, too, if he's wearing cologne, you can smell that shit. It is very obvious. And if you are around this person all the time, like, for example, when I was at work, and that person is suddenly wearing something different, you notice the smell immediately because it's unfamiliar to you, right? This is the thing that I hate about the current society, that our views on this kind of thing. Because we are animals, period. We follow, you know, the scent thing, you do realize that both, I assume, that I don't know necessarily the details about men, but women especially release pheromones just like animals do that men are attracted to. So when women wear this smelly stuff that makes them smell good, or at least it's supposed to make them smell good, and we pick up on it and we want to compliment that, we as in men, people with dicks, want to compliment it, and then we get called freaks because, you know, we're complimenting someone on their stink, is really fucking annoying. And it's also very, very scary. It's something that makes it difficult for me to want to talk to other people because I'm so afraid of the fact that, you know, oh, I'm going to get arrested because I complimented a girl on how her hair looks or how she smells, you know, or whatever, you know, oh, you must be using a new conditioner, therefore you smell really nice. And then they get all bent out of shape because you complimented them on the smell. Then why the fuck are you wearing something that smells? Don't use a conditioner that is made to make your hair smelly if you don't want people to talk about how it smells. It's that obvious. I think that should be straightforward and common sense. You know, it's if you as a not necessarily a girl, but a guy too, because, for example, I hate cologne. I don't wear cologne. I wear perfume. You can hear it right here, okay? And the reason I do this is because I think that it smells better. I do not like smelling like swamp water. I don't like men that wear cologne either. It's nasty smelling to me. Which, thank God, women do not wear cologne, at least not as commonly as they wear perfumes, which is supposed to smell sweeter and softer because it's a feminine product. And therefore, regardless of any sexist views, it's easier on my nose and it smells better. But if you, the point is if you take the cap off and you start spraying it like this, right? Okay? The point is you're putting this on for other people to smell it, period. No, I don't give a shit if you're putting it on for yourself or not. This is for other people to smell. So if someone compliments you on it and you get bent out of shape, I want your balls crushed. And if you're a girl, ovaries, okay? Because I cannot stand the way that society views that kind of thing these days. And the reason why I really liked the scene was because Ishigami, after being called a creep for, you know, and yes, he could have probably explained it a little bit better, how she smelled nice, because he's not very... I want to say socially skilled, you know, but that's also why people who might not have that experience, we should help these people, you know, get down into a conversation with them rather than just calling them out like this and basically having them run out of the room in shame because of the way that we treat them after all they wanted to do was compliment. You know, that's how I feel about these types of situations. But regardless, the way that he leaves and says, all I wanted to do was give a compliment, and in the end, it turned out to backfire, that was so relatable. It's ridiculous, you know? And that's another thing. The point I was bringing up earlier about pheromones is smell is a very big part of, you know, okay, and again, I'm not talking about just sniffing ass, okay? You know, that we're not going straight into, you know, we're not going that deep, literally. But smell is a very natural thing, and we as an animal use smell in a lot of our stuff. That's why, for example, like 75% of taste is what you smell. So when you're eating something and you plug your nose, you can't taste anything all of a sudden, or you're sniffing one food but eating another one, you can actually get the flavor from a different food. It's complicated, but that's because that's how our biology works. That's how we, you know, we as animals work that way. We might not have noses as strong as, you know, wolves or bears or whatever, but we don't live out in the trees either, so we don't need to adapt to that kind of thing anymore. But it's natural. It's only natural that that's how we are, you know. We fuck each other to survive as a species, and we're also one of the few species that can have sex for pleasure, and only pleasure. And thus, when one sex gives, when one gender, I should say, gives off these pheromones specifically to attract a mate, that is no different than how animals work. It's just that we are intelligent to the, at least to the degree that we can land on the moon. And so suddenly all of these animalistic ways shouldn't exist anymore. Well, I'm sorry, but you cannot get rid of that. That is just how we as a species are. You cannot hide that anymore. And I want to be able to compliment someone on how they look or how they smell without being ridiculed for it. And that's one reason why this scene was actually probably one of the most important scenes to me in the entire show. And I'm happy that they didn't fuck it entirely, right? It was still played out for comedic purposes, but they focused at least enough seriousness towards it. And it was very relatable. And since Ishigami was already a somewhat relatable character to me, it just felt like that was me in that position. I mean, I remember back when I was in school, I thought a girl that I sat next to had hair that smelled nice. And this was when I was in school, okay? This was when I was still very young. And I got taken out of the class and taken to the office because I had complimented on how her hair smelled, and she thought that was weird. And so I got taken out of the class for making that compliment. So ever since that day, that might be why I'm so bent out of shape myself about this topic, because that has stuck with me, and I just did not appreciate that at all. And if you as someone don't appreciate a compliment, that's your problem. Period. Okay. Off topic, we're getting trailed off. I'm getting into more of my own ranty stuff that I can save for another type of video. Sorry, but we'll move on now. We'll go to the next thing. So we're going to move into the end of the show, and I'm not going to rant about it, but I am going to bring it up. This show loves to follow the cold stuff. I mean, one of the characters gets a little cold in the beginning of the show. I think it's Chica. The temperature's dropping.
It sneezes.
Like, bitch, that's not how it works. But anyways, Kaguya, as I explained near the beginning of the video, she actually gets splashed with water from Miyuki, and she gets a cold from it. She catches a cold from it, because that's how water works, and then she ends up staying at home. Now, I wasn't too big on this stuff. I didn't like this at all, actually. When she's sick, she's having a fever, and apparently it makes her delirious as a character. Now, I'm not saying that this kind of thing isn't realistic, but I just didn't like how she was essentially not anything. She was a completely different character when she was delirious, and nothing that happened she remembers. So it was almost like, for her as a character, it was pointless, but they needed to make this scene so that they could create the argument and the fight that both Miyuki and Kaguya have in order to make the final episode that was coming up right afterwards more meaningful. That's the only reason I feel like this exists. At least from a storytelling point of view. Unfortunately, I didn't like any of it, so that's probably why I don't have very high opinions of it. And when I say fight, the argument they have, basically what happened was Miyuki went over to visit her and was getting a gift for her, but in her delirious state, and the fact that the maid, who realizes Kaguya likes Miyuki and vice versa, tries to... Actually, I don't know if this was the same maid. She had a different hairstyle. Regardless, tried to egg him on, you know, don't do anything suspicious with her in there while she's in her delirious state. But she's totally vulnerable. You know, it was doing that kind of stuff. He doesn't do anything. He doesn't do anything, he doesn't do anything dirty, I should say. But she, in her delirious state, pulls him into bed and they sleep together. They just fall asleep, normal casual sleeping. Unfortunately, when she wakes up out of her fever, she takes it the wrong way, gets very upset about that whole situation that occurred, and they have a fight at school. But the fight is comedic, right? They're not, like, screaming at each other. Like, in a drama romance, where things would be more adult and mature, where you would have an actual fight, here it's more for comedy purposes. But they are having a fight. And they, you know, they even go to their separate friends to look for advice about, you know, how do you know, oh, I've got this friend who had this fight with this girl, and here's the reason why, you know, how should he handle it, etc. And which was kind of cute to see. And they do finally end up making up. And the makeup is a pretty sweet scene, because we learn that Miyuki was hiding something. He did do something with her in bed. He put his finger on it, on her lip, and that was it. And in return, she found that to be really sweet and did it right back to him and said, you know, we're even. And that was it. And then there you go. They made up. And that was a cute scene. I like that. That scene was the only one that I liked and in what had come from before or after in terms of this romance stuff. Because what ends up happening next is the final episode of the show. Well, you've got episode 11, by the way. And I looked this up because it didn't make any sense to me. Episode 11 felt like filler, because you have this whole scene where Chika goes to a ramen shop and you just have this weird guy that, he's weird, like weirdly animated, and it just felt really out of place. I was like, what the hell is this? Why are we talking about ramen and like these, you know, these ancient ramen gods and stuff and how Chika's eating her ramen? I was like, this has got to be filler. Well, I looked it up on the internet and I don't have all the answers, but I found that the taxi driver that shows up at the end of the show is actually in relation to that ramen scene, and that's why they had the ramen scene, was to connect the two. But you would only know that if you had read the manga, and I have not read the manga. I did order one volume of the manga online. It's supposed to be showing up next week, I think. Unfortunately, I could only order one volume because everything else is out of stock. Fuck's sake. Of course it is. So maybe I'll find that out at some point, but in more detail. But regardless, that's what the ramen shop stuff is. And this is where we get the final episode, right? Or, you know, the last part of episode 11 and all of episode 12. And this is where things go a lot more serious as far as this show's concerned. So there's a festival, and Kaguya wants to go to the festival. She wants to see these fireworks because, you know, she doesn't have, like, this tragic backstory, you know, where her whole family fucking was murdered or something. It's not that dark. But she does have a pretty not fun backstory. She was raised basically as a princess. She was treated to everything except the stuff she really wanted. She was given so much, but never the type of thing that she would, you know, properly want. She was never treated well by her father. Not mistreated as in, you know, beaten or abused, but her father really doesn't get involved in her life at all. At least not as much as you would expect a father should, or at least would. And because of this, you know, all she wanted to do was go out and hang out with other people. She wanted to be with friends. She wanted to go places with other people. But she never got that as a kid. And she, as growing up, no matter what she was doing, if she was getting driven to school, she still yearned to be with other people. She had social desires. And I have to say that as far as relatable characters go, even though Kaguya might not be straight relatable to me like Ishigami was, this last scene was very relatable because it's something that I've been dealing with recently about wanting a social life but never having it basically over the past decade and having trouble getting it. And there's one scene with Kaguya in episode 12 that was so accurate to real life, to an experience that I've had in real life more times than I care to admit recently, that was hard to watch, but I watched it anyway, obviously. I don't know. I'm having trouble finding the words. Anyway, she wants to go to the festival, and of course, nope, she can't go. The family and their, like, pseudo-Yakuza won't let her leave the house. Suddenly, she can't leave the house because, oh, she'll get lost, there's too many people, and all this fucking bullshit, whatever, right? You know, what's stopping her from leaving? In fact, even the maid comes in and says, you know, what's stopping you from leaving? You've always have before. But this scene was pretty tough. So she's laying in bed and she was all ready to go to this celebration. And here's the part that got relatable for me. She's laying in bed, she cries, and all she says is that she wanted to go see the fireworks with everyone else, right? And then as she's laying in bed, the fireworks are outside going off. She's missing it. on screen, she's missing it, and there's nothing she can do about it right there in that moment. And all she wanted was to spend it with other people. You have no fucking clue how many times this happens to me on a daily basis, how I will go through this scenario that she went through, where I think about wanting to do something with people, or seeing something happening outside, or seeing something that's going on somewhere around that I wanted to go to with other people as well, and not being able to, and I just have to sit there and endure while it happens, and I just sob in my bed. That was the most relatable part of her character for me. Thankfully, because this is a rom-com, it gets resolved in about 3 minutes. She gets out with the help of her maid, and she runs off to go see the fireworks, and surprisingly, she doesn't make it. She misses out. She shows up right when the fireworks have ended and everyone's leaving the festival, which was pretty shocking, but because it's a rom-com, give it another 2 minutes and everything will be resolved. And that's the reason why I cannot stand this last episode. And Miyuki shows up, as he does, of course he does, and takes her off to a nearby city with the use of the taxi driver, where they can see the fireworks of the nearby city. But what was kind of special about this scene was that, despite all of this desire to watch these fireworks, she didn't look at them at all. Instead, she stared right at Miyuki, which, you know, shows how far her feelings have come over the 12 episodes. And then they return to school, and everything's kind of back to normal. I mean, they're kind of, like, a little bit awkward with each other because of what had happened recently. But everything goes back to normal, and, you know, she talks about... It looks like they're going to confess to each other, right? Right here in episode 12. It looks like they're about to confess. One or the other is going to confess. You know, and they're tossing around... You know, I think Kaguya tosses around the word thank you, and it's... And, Miyuki misinterprets it and runs away from her, and then the credits roll, and then they kind of just end the show somewhere in and around there. And there is no resolve to the romance. Obviously, there is a second season, mind you, so, you know, I would assume that that's only going to improve. And it's based on, I think it's based on the manga. Therefore, again, the manga would have covered this probably later in the series. But here's the thing I gotta say about the ending, okay? Because there is no resolve, and because when this show was released, there was no second season, this wasn't an extended season, it was a short 12 episodes, you know, and people weren't immediately ready to, or weren't immediately set to watch a season 2, because not only had it not been released, but as far as I can tell, for even upwards of a year or two afterwards, it hadn't been ready. So people just had to settle with this as anime-only watchers, because not everyone reads manga. Not everyone reads the manga of the shows that they're watching. Like I have been for many years, I've watched mostly the anime, and only recently, whoops, I forgot I had boxes there, and only recently started collecting manga. And some of the manga I have aren't even of shows I've watched, so that doesn't really count, I guess. But what made it so disappointing was the fact that there is no resolve. No, I don't need to see the characters fucking each other by the last episode, okay? Because, I gotta bring this up because the only reason I'm bringing it up this way is because I saw that there was a lot of people very disappointed with the ending of the show as of the time that it was released. And there were people who defended the show saying, if you really expected them to get together after only 12 episodes, wow. You know, the thing that I have to counter with that is, this show itself shows us how far their romance had come in such a short period of time. It's not like certain other rom-coms I've watched where you'll go through 20 episodes and nothing happens, and then suddenly in the last 2 episodes they start wanting to screw each other and get married, right? It's not like that. From the very beginning, these two characters already like each other, and it gets stronger, and it gets super strong by the end. So to not get a resolve to that, when the show itself is showing us that, regardless of any source material, yes, I think we have a right to be disappointed by there not being a resolve to the story. Obviously, it's easier for me now to have watched this these days rather than watching it in 2019, because that means that I have access to a second season, and there's a third season coming out in only a couple months, or starting to release in only a couple months, so I'm in a better position than people were back then. I can say, oh, I'll just go watch season 2 then, and maybe I'll get a resolve to my issues there, right? You know, and because they are connected via seasons, it's not kind of, you know, it's kind of not like how I felt originally about Evangelion, how it's got a movie spinoff, but it's actually a sequel, but it's actually not a sequel. To have to rely on spinoff or external content, I don't like. I remember ranting in that that review about how I just don't like in video games when if you want to know anything about the lore or, you know, there's something that you should know already, but you have the only way to learn it is you got to buy a book and read that instead. Then don't fucking give me the game. You know, if you have the game that covers that shit, then cover the shit in the game. And that's kind of how I feel about these shows too. Don't make me go off and watch a whole bunch of other random side shit and spinoff shit to get the answers to anything. Give it to me in the actual show or the actual movie. Seasons 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever, I consider that to be okay. So I'm not going to hold this against the show, the fact that there is no resolve. The other disappointing stuff was just that I did not like the seriousness. The fact that it is a rom-com meant that you had these, oh, she's crying, she's depressed, that's horrible, it's really, you know, it's really relatable, but it's a rom-com. I know it's going to be resolved almost immediately, and it is resolved practically immediately. And therefore, I couldn't really feel, well, I could feel relation to how she felt in those scenes, I couldn't feel any kind of attachment to the character in that scene. I couldn't feel like, oh no, you know, I don't know how to explain it. It's just that it just did not work. It didn't work because it's a comedy show. That's why I don't think these types of scenes work in comedy shows. Whatever, a lot of people thought it was really good, so maybe, you know, whatever, maybe I'm in the minority on that. But regardless, overall, the show did not hurt me. It didn't hurt me personally. It didn't make me upset I'm annoyed with this obnoxious show. It didn't make me feel that way. It basically, like I said at the beginning, it bounced its way around all the issues I usually have with these genres and tags and themes and character tropes and all that kind of stuff. It bounced its way around that. Did it better and or did it at least in a right way that didn't annoy me? And I think on my analyst, I explained that this show is above what rom-com usually shits out. But it's not as high, or I don't acquire from it what I would get out of a drama romance, because it's not as deep, or it's not as adult, as I had said earlier. It's somewhere right in the middle of being shit and being amazing. But it's slightly above being, you know, just average. I put it at an 8.1 rating. Despite all the bitching I've been doing, I put it at an 8.1 rating. And I put it at an 8.1. I was going to settle with about an 8, maybe a 7.9, but I don't think I'm willing to drop below 8 for this show. I hate having to talk about the rating because my rating system is so freaking stupidly complicated. It's dumb. I don't even have it written down for anyone to read publicly. It's just a personal rating list. I'll make it, if I ever get done with that work in progress profile description I have on my analyst, I'll put it in there someday. But that's been work in progress since 2018, since June 2018 to boot, or July. Anyways, as I was saying, I put it at an 8.1, slightly above what I would consider, well, no, 8 isn't above average for me, but above average of what I would consider a rom-com, right? That's what I mean. Not necessarily just my rating system. And that's what puts it at an 8 alone. It went to an 8 because it wasn't just another shitty rom-com, right? But it, of course, doesn't go super high because it didn't do anything very special. You know, my 8 rating range is when I think, oh, these shows are pretty good, or, you know, the higher the range goes, they're great. But in order to really get a high-end 8 from me, and especially to get a legendary rating, which is a 9 to 10, you have to go beyond. You don't have to be, you can literally be a perfect show, you know, and not do anything wrong, and I can think that you're perfectly fine, and I don't even have a single negative thing to say, and you can get like a 7 out of 10. Because you have to go above and beyond to reach the higher ratings for me. It's not a 10 out of 10 for me isn't just masterpiece by definition. You have to go beyond what the general, whatever my general idea of, you know, those criteria of show are. And this one did go above and beyond. It went above what a rom-com usually is, and that's what made it more enjoyable for me. I didn't find it obnoxious, and I put it at an 8.1 because of some of the other aspects I liked about it, like the visuals and the characters and how I didn't dislike any of the characters and all that kind of stuff. I put some other details in there in my notes, but for the most part, that's how I felt about the show by the end. And I was very happy with that. I was very happy with the fact that I enjoyed the show by the end. You know, the first two episodes, if it went like that all the way through, you could have been looking at a 7 out of 10. A show, maybe even less, a show that I just wasn't too big on. And you'll find that a majority of my shows are between 7 and 10. They're 7, 8s, and 9s. I don't have a 10 out of 10 anywhere, but I think the highest is a 9.9, which is what I gave the Evangelion movie. But, you know, the general idea is that sevens are okay shows. Shows that, lower end sevens are like, there were some aspects I liked, but you might think, oh, well, seven's a pretty high though, right? Well, yes and no, not for my list. The seven is actually when shows are kind of okay. Low end seven is when you're barely scraping by. Sixes are boring. Sixes are shows that I just did not like for the most part. The reason they're sixes is because I don't think anything's just an absolute, unworthy mess. If they're in the six range, it just means I didn't like your show. I thought it was boring, or maybe it annoyed me. Five, oh, you done fucked it up. And anything below five, you might as well have not existed. Panty and stocking. So eights, high-end sevens are good. I think high-end sevens are pretty good shows or pretty okay shows, like mid-range sevens, like a 7.5, for example, is an okay range of shows. High-end sevens are pretty good shows, and eights are great shows. So you'll go up and, lower-end eights are great shows, mid-range eights are like, okay, wow, you're definitely kicking some ass, and high-end eights, you really have to earn a high-end eight. But in the nines, of course, if you have to earn a high-end eight, you can imagine how difficult it might be to get into the nine range. And the only other thing to keep in mind about my rating system is the fact that movies are rated differently. See, I have to rate shows differently than movies because movies are maybe 1 to 2 hours you sit there for. Shows, you sit there for 5 to 10 plus hours through that much content. There's a lot more to dig through, a lot more to break down. So, yes, Evangelion's movie is a 9.9, but in equivalent to what a show's rating would be, it's probably like maybe a 9.3 or something, somewhere in around that range. It's not above all of my other 9.0 shows and stuff like that. That's why if you look at my favorites list, just because it's a higher rating than my other movies doesn't mean I suddenly like it more than my 9.7 rated anime. It's, like I said, very complicated the way that I do my rating system. I'll try to explain it. Maybe I'll do its own video. It's the whole fucking breakdown video on how my ratings work in the future someday. And I have considered dropping my ratings all by 1 point. I've thought about what if I were to drop every rating on my list down by 1 point, just so that I can expand and stretch it out so that, sevens would be sixes now, and eights would be sevens, nines would be eights, and then anything that was higher end might be in the nine range. But I don't think I'm ever going to do that. I think I'm going to keep it as I have. This system is how it's worked for me for a long time, and of course, as is the disclaimer with everything I do, just because I like something, just because I put it at a higher rating or at a lower rating doesn't mean it's suddenly better or worse than shows in and around it. It's just how I kind of cobbled everything together and how I feel as an end result. This show I might like better than an 8.5 show I watch. It's hard to explain, but that's sometimes how it works. And this show I might not like as much as a 7.7 show. You see, it's really weird how it works, but that's how it works. Either way, I felt like this was a fair rating range to give it, and I think that as far as it goes, I think most of the love it gets is deserved. And I wouldn't say it's overrated or anything, unlike some other shows. But with that being said, of course, if you've seen... I almost said the other show on accident. If you've seen Kaguya-sama, Love is War, feel free to post your opinions on it in the description. Excuse me, I always say description. Why do I say that? In the comment section down below, and I will see your comments down there. Of course, you can always suggest new anime or manga or visual novels you want me to cover, and I'll add them to their respective lists. The only ones I don't cover are ongoing shows, which are shows that are currently releasing and have no end schedule. If they are releasing and have an end schedule, of course I can add them, I just probably won't watch them until they're done. So, for example, shows like One Piece I don't cover because they just keep fucking releasing, and I don't know how to cover shows like that yet. Anyhow, that's going to bring this one to an end. As far as what comes next in our list, I am adding Season 2 and all that kind of stuff to my watch list, as I would like to watch it at some point for this show, but that's not what's coming next. Next will be the Chinese animation, Flavors of Youth, which will actually be the very first Chinese anime that I track on my list. So this is going to be a bunch of fun.